Well, payback is no, I don't need that. I've got one of these fancy thingamabobbies. Here, get your pay stuff out of here, would you?
Good Lord. Good Lord.
See if this works.
Yep.
Okay. Thanks. It's not very often that he introduces me. I spent most of my time introducing him over the years, and I never had enough ammunition to properly take care of it. I'm thrilled to be here tonight because I look around and I see so many of the crew that I got to sail with over the years. I've got Tim O'Keefe, and I've got Paul Bouchef, and George Denny, and Fred Dabney, and then there's Bill Cook, who very kindly in 2003 invited me to go sailing up to Greenland in July, and I'm sitting there saying, why in the world would anybody want to go and freeze their butts off up there when you could go sailing in Buzzards Bay and have a really nice time of it? But he, and this is a man I hardly knew, and he very kindly took me along with some others, and he plans his trips in such a way that he divides it into northbound and southbound. And I felt that it was really more important to be going northbound on all these trips because it was the experience of getting to a place that you hadn't seen, whereas the southbounders were flying in and hopping on the boat. And by that point, I don't mean to be rude, but Bill was sort of getting like he sort of wanted to get home. And so the southbound trip turned out to be a little briefer. And of course, the problem is when you're that far north, that if you get a north wind, you've really got to take advantage of it. So I was lucky to go along on four trips with Bill up there, actually several others, but the four we'll talk about tonight is two trips up to Labrador and then two trips to Greenland. Preparations for these is a lot more than packing your sea bag and boarding the boat at the appointed time. All members of the crew have prep work, and my contribution has evolved into provisioning and cooking. So you're not getting the captain's point of view this evening. You're getting the low man on the totem pole, I tell you. Getting enough food to feed a crew of four for 6 to 8 weeks takes an awful lot of time, and it took, I think, just the non-perishable foods took anywhere from 3 to 5 grocery cart loads at the grocery store. I had developed, with the help of an admiral friend of mine, an Excel spreadsheet that would get us through being able to figure out exactly what we needed for all these trips. But we were very lucky because we had a lot of people who knew Bill and crewed with Bill, and they would supply us with some frozen meals. I mean, Subi O'Keefe, who's here tonight, made I don't know how many great curry dishes for us that we would eat on the way up there. But finding space on board the boat was often the biggest challenge. Remembering where I put the stuff was even more of a challenge. Luckily, Resolution, Bill's 56-foot Bristol, was ample space for all of this and a freezer big enough to get lost in. A center cockpit configuration kept us dry, and the occasional use of the S-bar heater, it was a very occasional use of the S-bar heater, kept us warm. The midship's salon was a great spot for many great meals and discussions. Bill's choice of crew was always spot on, and I've been fortunate enough to sail with some of the best shipmates that you could ever ask for. All our trips started at Burr Brothers Boatyard in Marion, with family and friends giving us last-minute advice, like, be careful, or as Sandy Weld always said, rule number one, don't fall off, being the most repeated. Tony Cook, Bill's wife, always came down to the Cape Cod Canal and gave us a great big wave as we went off. And that was really sort of the beginning of the cruises for all of us. It was really kind of a nice point. It was also her birthday, and she was making sure that Bill just kept going. Labrador in 2007 was our first trip. That year, our objective was to go up the entire length of the province, transit the McClellan Strait across McClellan Strait. Oops, sorry, folks. I can't go back. Anyway, you lose that one. cross go up to McClellan Strait, cross Ungava Bay to the west, and explore the Leaf Basin, where the tides are reported to be higher than even the Bay of Fundy. It's 1,000 miles from Marion across from Marion across Nova Scotia, through the Labrador lakes of Cape Breton Island, and up the west coast of Newfoundland to the Straits of Belle Isle. This part of the northbound trip is basically a nonstop sprint, as we all want to get to Labrador. This takes us a very long week, but we just muck on through and do it. At Belle Isle, the weather always changes. The days are noticeably longer. We enter the Labrador Current, and icebergs start to appear. Fog, drizzle, and more fog often envelop us, and it's now cold. Night sailing is mostly curtailed, and even and evening anchoring is the norm. It took about 3 days and 250 miles to our first major stop in Mekovic, where we refuel and rewater. Mekovic has about 300 people, where a fish plant is its largest employer. They process crab, shrimp, and whatever fish is in season for 3 or 4 months a year. All bulk supplies come in via ship when the ice allows. We were here in mid-July, and the ice had only been gone for less than a month. We left early the next morning, and it was there as there were several hundred miles to go. Our next stop was the abandoned Moravian settlement in Hebron. This magnificent long house comprised chapel, store, school, kitchen, and living accommodations for the entire community. And restoration had just begun, and what was to take a decade or more to get completed. The building season here is also only about 8 weeks a year, and all materials have to be brought in by small boat, then offloaded and carried by site to the yard. The original building was a prefab kit made and shipped over from England in the 1830s. Parts were numbered with carved Roman numerals to facilitate reassembly. Our way north took us by several well-known landmarks, Mugford Tickle, the Bishop's Mitre at 3,750 feet, and Cape White Handkerchief, one of the most well-known points on the coast, named for the massive intrusion of white rock. I'm not sure, is that quartz, Bill? I never found out. He was our guide. He was supposed to know all of this. We had to leave all of these at least a mile offshore, as there was, at that time, only one line of soundings on this entire part of the coast. You see a 1,500-foot cliff dropping into the water, and you just know there has to be several fathoms beside it. But we were an awful long way from the nearest rescue or travel lift, so we prudently followed where we knew the water was. McClellan Straits is at the top of Labrador, separating the mainland from Killiniq Island and Cape Chidley, Labrador's official northernmost point at about 60 degrees north latitude. The tides were never well understood, as boat traffic is practically non-existent. Bill had done his research and felt we had a pretty good feel for the ebb and flow, so on a very cold, drizzly, mostly foggy morning, we set off, and 3 hours later, we got through without incident. The research was spot on, and we had a slack tide for the whole way through. That was enough excitement for the day, so we found an incredibly snug little 3-acre pond in the abandoned settlement of Port Burwell. With our anchor down, soup and grilled cheese sandwiches soon appeared. I went on deck to check the water temperature when I spotted this magnificent animal walking down the shore. Soup forgotten, cameras and our protective gun came on deck, and we had a fabulous time taking pictures. And it was pretty close, and that is until he slipped into the water, swam out towards us. At that point, somebody said something like, holy something, he's getting close. We had been told that swimming bear could probably get his forepaws up to the rail, but without any back foot support, because he was swimming, that was about as close as he could get. We never found out, for as soon as we spoke, he turned around and swam ashore, shook off, and sauntered away over the hill. We finally calmed down and had a pleasant evening. The next morning, He was asleep on the rocks directly astern, hoping one of us wanted to go for a morning dip. They look really cute, but you have to understand, we're part of their food chain. So we were a little worried. We then crossed the 175 miles of Ungava Bay and Leaf Basin the next afternoon. Our destination was Tassiuyak, a small community up the Leaf River. The 10-knot current was against us when we got there, so we anchored in the designated ship anchorage area well over a mile offshore. Here, we were visited by an Inuit family who were returning to their summer camp after a successful seal hunt. Let's see if I can do this right. There, it's right there. They were very surprised to see us, and as we learned the next day, we were the first sailboat anybody could ever remember seeing. We were even asked what that big stick in the middle of the boat was for. We didn't have a good answer for that one, if I remember. We spent the next day refueling via rubber dinghy using a borrowed 55-gallon drum, our fuel transfer pump, and many shuttle trips. It's a weird feeling to know that at high tide you need to have at least 60 feet of depth for a safe anchorage. We discovered that this area had the highest average tide range of any place, but that Fundy, because there's so many people and so many scientists nearby, has recorded the highest one-time tide. There are no wharfs here, as ice would carry them away. All supply ships are LST types with bow ramps. You can see how large the landing ramp is just by looking at the ramp in the background, and that's at half tide. With an 11-knot ebbing tide, we raced out to Ungava Bay at over 17 knots and motored all night back to Port Burwell. Spent the night there, then through the McClellan Strait and on to the Labrador coast again, with the Torngat Mountains holding the cloud cover tightly. Our new plan was to arrive at Saglek Fjord, where a charter flight would meet us at the old Dew Line station and get us home. We stopped one night at Seaplane Cove, a special place to our family. My wife Tally's grandfather, Dr. Alexander Forbes, in 1931 organized a mapping expedition to the northern part of Labrador using his 90-foot schooner, the Rama, and two seaplanes. Both of them biplanes, to take the photographs that were used to eventually make the maps. He named their base Seaplane Cove, so coming in there was pretty neat. Little did I know how important the Forbes expedition was until we arrived at Saglek, where we discovered a small tent city. Here we were visited by a boatload of folks who turned out to be federal and provincial dignitaries here for the official opening of the Torngat National Park. We were invited ashore for a tour, and while there, they were thrilled to learn of my Forbes connection. It seems his mapping was a crucial part of the history of this area and instrumental in the government creating the park. Asked if they had a guest register, the provincial park commissioner raced back to her tent and produced her unused journal book, and thus Resolution and her crew were the very first visitors to the park. Except for a few caribou who swam by to see what all the excitement was about. It was a perfect end to our northbound cruise. We went to the Saglek Dew Line airfield, chased the caribou off the runway so that the plane could land, and greeted our replacements. It was such a beautiful day that the flight crew asked if we could do a little sightseeing on the way. So we flew out the Saglek Fjord for several miles below the rim and eventually flew home to 90-degree Boston. We thought maybe Labrador was looking pretty good at that point. Last year's trip was a little bit more relaxed. We set as a goal to take Resolution to Resolution Island, about 50 miles north of Cape Chidley. Those plans quickly went out the window with a northeast gale in the Gulf of Maine that delayed our departure 2 days. A pleasant sail up to Cape Breton and the Brador Lakes was followed by a decision to put into Dingwall, the last harbor before the Cabot Straits, to let another blow pass us by. This is Dingwall coming in. Two nights later, we had a leisurely motor sail out along the Newfoundland coast finally passed Belle Isle 10 days out. Our first anchorage was Ship Harbor, and we could not have asked for a prettier place to spend the night, though the water was noticeably colder. Leaving the next morning, we spotted up ahead a large iceberg that we determined, using sextant and radar, was 251 feet tall. We think sitting on the bottom in several hundred feet. Bergs were visible all the time now, so we decided not to travel at night, and we became tourists and sightseers. Clothing for warmth was essential. We all had exposure suits, down jackets, wool caps, and heavy mittens or gloves. And we needed them. Breakfast consisted of hot, cold cereal, eggs, potatoes, pancakes, bacon, or whatever. Lunches were hot sandwiches and soup. Cocoa or soup at any time of the day were offered. We often had a few nibbles and a wee dram before a full-on meal at... Oh, come on, slow down, Skip. There we go. That's our wee dram. Before we had a full-on dinner. We pulled into Makovic a few days later for fuel, water, and a few supplies just ahead of the weekly supply ferry. Dinner was ashore at the only restaurant. Let's just say that after that meal, my stock as cook went way up. Out and on the road again at the usual 0600, we slowly worked our way up the coast to Seaplane Cove. This is, again, another shot of Cape White Handkerchief. We stopping along the way at the Torngat National Park Base Camp to get our cruising permit. Things have changed. They've gotten official up there, even though they're only open for about 6 to 8 weeks a year. Seaplane Cove became our northernmost point on this trip, and we still... I didn't do that. Anyway, that was us celebrating. The next morning we went for a walk, but it was so foggy that Bill said that we've got to get back aboard the boat because it was very easy for a polar bear, to just being as white as that fog, to walk up on us on the beach. And so we just said, let's go. So we pulled aboard and away we left. We were heading south again, and Rama Bay, about 40, 50 miles south, was our next planned anchorage, but it proved to be untenable. We opted to head a bit further south. That day was spectacular. There's a great picture of Cape White Handkerchief, and you can see that great white rock intrusion. Blue skies, light wind, a fair current, the entire Torngat range in front of us. And here you have the tip of Labrador is 60 degrees north, so we were above 59 degrees north at this point. And I think the tree line was down near just above Nain, which was probably another 100 miles south of that. Now you made me lose my place here. Oh, Bill had been told that the north arm of the Saglac... Oh, that's right. We got to go spend the night, and then this is where we spent the night. I did lose my place. Tally said I was going to lose my place if I wasn't careful. Bill had been told that the north arm of the Saglac Fjord was one of the most fabulous anchorage anywhere. So off we trekked, the 25 miles up the inlet. High cliffs, waterfalls, geologic shapes all over the place. The lifts and folds of the hills in there is spectacular. We just sat there. I call these areas sort of sensory overload. When you start looking at these, they just are, you just never know what you're going to see next. We came to the north arm, and as we entered, the wind came in behind us and grew stronger every minute. The katabatic winds were soon blowing a steady 25 to 30 knots. Now, every sailor knows that the worst place to anchor is on a lee shore, but that's what we did. Setting a 100-pound anchor with 200 feet of chain in 30 feet of water, and still our transom was only 3 boat lengths away from the shore. Needless to say, we all four spent the rest of the afternoon taking bearings, making sure we weren't drifting, but it wouldn't have made any difference. It would have happened so fast. But the wind slowly died so that by evening, we were in flat, calm water. And conditions remained so for the rest of the night. We took another foggy morning walk ashore the next morning to stretch our legs, again being watchful for bear, both black and polar at this point. We saw none. We next motored back to the Torngat base camp for the night and were invited ashore to dine with the park staff. In the morning, cold and raw again, we were surrounded by 20 inflatables from a 400-foot cruise ship and 200 young people in a program called Kids on Ice. They were from all over the world, with one-third of them making sure that they came from Arctic communities. It was a cultural, scientific, and educational cruise around Labrador and Greenland. We mingled with the kids for about an hour, but were called back aboard as we had to hit the road again. It was really a neat program, and they've been doing it for years, and I think it's subsidized by the Canadian government or private foundations that put this together. Our destination today was back to Hebron, where Bill and I had last been in 2007. The weather was crummy, the preferred anchorage was way too exposed, so when we got in, we found a lee on the other side of the embayment and hunkered down for the night. Next morning, it has a memory, I guess, doesn't it? Next morning, it was a much nicer day, and we went ashore and moved over, and the local crew gave us a tour. It was amazing how much things had changed. The chapel was restored, and they had begun to work on the rest of the interior. The entire exterior was done, and it was fabulous. It really looked compared to what it was in 2007. It was quite a change. Our guide, Levi, was born here and was only a young boy in 1959 when the government forcibly resettled the entire community to Mokovic and Nain. Ultimately, this proved to have been a mistake. And in the early 2000s, the government formally apologized, a statement commemorated with a bronze plaque on site. Next to it is another bronze plaque with the Inuit response, saying basically, "We accept your apology, but with this plaque here today, we will hold you to your promises made." Nothing like having your promises written down in bronze, so the government doesn't have a way out on that one. Further south, we went through the Mugford Tickle, a quarter-mile wide passage with 1,000-foot cliffs on each side and 900 feet beneath our keel. Our path then took us down an inside passage to Port Manvers Run. That would be here. We came in here, and then we went down and around and through like this, and we put into Challenger Cove down there. And that's where we saw our first bear, a little black bear. It was the only bear we saw, actually. The cove was named after the ship that surveyed the waters and not the ill-fated shuttle. We knew we were getting south because here we were starting to see trees again. The next day, we went into Nain, our place of departure. Here we met up with the new southbounders, and Bill had a whole new crew to entertain him as we flew home. The Greenland trips were a whole different kettle of fish. Our 2003 objective was Disko Bay at 59 degrees north and about 1,200 miles north of the Straits of Belle Isle. It took 12 days of continuous running to sight Greenland, and we were very surprised at just how rugged it was. We really thought we were going to be seeing all ice. At least I thought we were going to be seeing all ice. And to see these mountains like this from a distance was amazing. We raised our courtesy flag. And quarantine flags and landed in Manitsoq, where we were able to squeeze into the Saturday morning dock and get refueled. And we got great advice on seeing this area of the country. Using the information gleaned by the local people there, we decided to inspect Hamburger Sound, passing through mountainous, wonderful, craggy areas and up a fjord to a snug anchorage and our first full night's sleep in a couple of weeks. The next day, we went through a very tight little village, inlet, and with the small town there. If you look at this boat, if you actually can see right there, that's a harpoon gun that they have on a lot of these boats, and I think they're using it for seal. I don't think they're allowed to hunt whale up there, but I'm not sure on that. But the village was really very picturesque. Their sewage system needs a little bit of work, but but other than that, it was pretty nice. That night, after leaving there, we went back out to sea and made an overnight hop. That night, we also crossed over the... what have I hit here? It's just getting tired. Looks good here. Time out. It was supposed to be that the other projector that was the problem. This is a close up of this polar bear. So we crossed the Arctic Circle and we had a blue nose ceremony. This is an honored when you cross any of the three great circles, the Arctic Circle, the Antarctic Circle. You become a member of the Blue Nose, and if you cross the equator, you become a shellback. This particular ceremony was officiated by Skadi, the goddess of the north, because Neptune was way too busy taking care of the New York Yacht Club, who were going all the way up to Nova Scotia. So. We had to settle for Skadi, and she was wonderful and did a great job, and we all got our blue noses, and that was great. The next day, we stopped for lunch in this wonderful little cove for a nap and just to have a little peace and quiet, and it gave us a chance to really start to begin to understand the rugged beauty of Greenland. On the right-hand picture there, that is a tree, believe it or not. It's about 3 feet tall. It's up against a south-facing rock, and I have been told that it could easily be 100 years old. Crossing Disco Bay, we were awestruck by the size and numbers of icebergs that calve from the one major glacier near Ilulissat. I'll keep using this. This town, Ilulissat, has a population of about 4,500 people and is a major tourist spot known for its fast-moving glacier. Moving at 140 feet a day, it calves enough ice to supply New York City with a day's worth of water. At any given time, I'm going to go over here. At any given time, we had anywhere from 30, 20 to 30 icebergs all the time. I should probably stand over here. At any given time, there's 20 to 30 icebergs to see at all the time. Some were just huge. This one was well over 200 feet tall. The ones that escape Disko Bay get caught in the West Greenland Current and glide north and often get hung up for a few years in the crook of Melville Bay, a couple of hundred miles north, before inching out into the South Labrador Current, where that takes them down Baffin Island, Labrador, Newfoundland, and out to the North Atlantic. It's quite possible that a berg from this glacier did in the Titanic. On this trip, the icebergs were the star. We met our southbound crew in Assiut, and then we took off and they went off with Bill. The takeoff was pretty exciting because the airfield has a nice curve hump in the middle of it. So you work up your speed and you get up to the top of the hill and you can't see what you're going, and then you get over the top and you hope you've got enough speed because you're committed to a takeoff and all you see in front of you is the water. We did fine. In 2010, we had another crew for Resolution, and again we headed for Greenland, but this time our focus was at the far south of Greenland, at the Cape Farvel area. I should say that these trips are not without incident, and we had our share this time. Before we even got to Nova Scotia, our jib furler failed, and we had to put into Halifax to remove, repair, and reinstall the entire unit. We also had to remove and repair Captain Bill. Chris Parkman did all of our mast work, but it was Bill who got all the attention, cutting his hand and banging his head before we got into town. All repaired, boat and crew, we headed out. Days later, we were off Newfoundland, fighting some bad fuel. We had to change fuel filters continuously. We got pretty good at this after a while. At the same time, a low pressure system developed that required us to turn around for 24 hours. But eventually we arrived in Nanortalik, the southernmost town in Greenland. It was late in the day when we arrived, so we found a place to tie up, arranged to get fuel and water the next morning, and called it a night. As usual, we had to check the water temperature before we turned in. Imagine our surprise when waking up the next morning to find a Carnival Cruise Line monster anchored out and hordes of folks coming ashore. Nanortalik is a regular stop for cruise lines visiting Greenland, and the town's folks put on a great exhibit. We wandered around the town on a warm, sunny morning, enjoying the flowers, the culture, and the costumes of the people. When they found out we were off that sailboat that was docked there, they visibly warmed up to us. Those were seal jackets and clothing that they were wearing. Our main objective on this trip was to transit the Prince Christian Sund passage over to the east coast. And that day was the last truly sunny day of our voyage. It was a perfect time for a crew picture. And it could not have been better timed. We slid down the coast and then turned inland through a winding group of fiords made up of islands to a place we dubbed the Five Corners. We were several miles inland, and this spot offered us five different ways to get back to the open sea, all with high, craggy peaks. I wouldn't want to try to climb that, and yet I know that there's people who think that that's fun to do, but... We found a place to anchor for the night, and the next day headed to Prince Christian Sund. That's Rick moving the iceberg aside, but basically he was moving the boat. The iceberg was not going to move. We went off to Prince Christian Sound the next day, but those katabatic winds are in Greenland also. And we were heading right into it. The sound is a 35-mile, straight-as-an-arrow waterway, deep on both sides with no place to anchor, and with 25 to 30-knot winds funneling down against us. After 2 hours and progress of 2 miles, we called it quits. We were abreast of this glacier for almost all of that time. We got back to the Five Corners and found a short, dead-end fjord to anchor in. It was our most spectacular anchorage. We went for a walk the next morning, and it was here that we felt more isolated than at any point in any of the trips that we ever took with Bill. You just don't realize how stark and bare the country is up there. If you'll also notice, we were a little bit more adventurous in Greenland than as to where we went, mainly a result because the Danish government has, having surveyed most of the coastal waters, producing many good navigational charts. So we knew what we were getting into when we went into some of these places. One of the great things about sailing on Resolution is that Bill always had every chart that you could imagine. Matter of fact, I think we lost a couple of bunks just for the chart storage on it, but he always had every chart. So navigating, we were using GPS. We had chart plotters, as you saw there. I think on the second Labrador trip, we were using cell phone and iPads for a lot of the navigating that was going on. But the charts were always really nice to be able to sit there and get a better feel for where we were. It was at this point in the trip that we went to explore the only forest in all of Greenland. We had to get there first, and it was just, the fog came in, the rain came down, and it was just almost as spectacular as we were working our way south towards the forest area. I like this button better. Now the forest was to get to the forest, we had about a 2 mile hike inland, and then a small boat ride down about an 8 to 10 mile lake to get to the forest area. Our guide spoke very little English, except when the outboard motor died in the middle of the lake. In the stunned silence, all we heard was engine broke. By this time, we were pretty adept at fixing engines. And in short order, we were back in business. It was a very simple process. He hadn't opened up the vent on the outboard tank. It was amazing to see trees 15 feet tall at 61 degrees north. We have no idea how old they were. For the next couple of days, we wended our way through down towards the town of Kakartok and more fuel. In the fjords, with all the peaks around, sailing rarely happens. I think on this trip alone, we motored over 250 hours. We arrived at Narsarsuaq in time to meet our southbounders and fly home by way of Iceland. To give you a feel of the size of Greenland, we flew out over the narrowest southern tip of the island, and it still took 20 minutes of flight time to reach the east coast. Looking down, we thought we were looking at mountains popping through the clouds, but until we realized it was all ice that we saw, and knowing the peaks were 4,000 footers, you come to realize just how much ice there really must be there. It was, I think that was one of the more eye-opening parts of the entire trip, was to fly over this one area of it. Now, cooking on these trips is fun, but sometimes challenging. Granted, a lot of the time we are at anchor, and some of the meals were pre-cooked and just needed heating up. But there were still some great concoctions. A chicken taco salad in Labrador, curried chicken over rice, pork tenderloins or fresh char, even fresh bread. The big mystery was that we ate a lot at every meal, and yet we all lost weight. We figured it was because Bill was trying to save fuel on the S-bar heater, and we lived 24 hours a day at 40 degrees Fahrenheit. We just shivered the weight off. I always try to make the last dinner aboard something special, a roast leg of lamb being a favorite of mine. I do this for selfish reasons. The last meal is generally the only meal the crew remembers, and that could lead to another invitation. So I'll leave you with a little bit of dessert. Now, the important part of these cruises are the crews that you're with. And this is a composite of all the crews that we had on this trip, on the, all these trips, and they were fabulous. And then many thanks to Bill for putting all these together. And I'm done. Thank you very much. Now, I'm certainly willing to answer questions, and I'm sure if I can't answer them, there's a few crew members in here who know a lot more than I do. Yes, Chris? No, the skipper had a rule that no blood and guts on the deck, so no fishing. But there were plenty of char around that we could have gotten our hands on. When we went to that forest in Greenland that time, on the way back to the to where we got out of the little boat, we stopped and he had a gill net down and there were a bunch of char there and he was offering them to us, but if he hadn't cleaned them, we might have taken them at that point. Yes, John.
Did you notice any evidence of global warming on these
rivers? Yes, in Narsarsuaq, we had a couple of days where we toured around with a couple of people who were talking about how they had been doing some core studies on the depth, and they had gone out in previous years and they had stuck a pole many meters down into the ice. And in the following summer, when the scientists came back, there were, instead of just being a 1 meter of pole showing, there were several meters of the pole showing. So there is definitely ice melting there a lot. Up in Ilulissat, the glacier moved so fast anyway that we thought that this was because of global warming, but we were told that historically that glacier in Ilulissat moves at 140 feet a day, and it hasn't seen much there. Now, maybe the level of ice has dropped down a little bit, but that's about it. Yep.
You mentioned using a gun to protect yourself from the polar bears. What did you do to either see them or keep them away from you? Noisemakers or anything like that?
On the second trip to Labrador this past year, the first time we went up, we took a big rifle, and that would have been great, but we really didn't want to use it, so we just had it on deck at that time. When you saw that bear that we showed there, that was the only polar bear we ever saw. On the Labrador trip, we took a 12-gauge shotgun with us, and we took some bear bangers. Now, up in the Torngat National Park and all the national parks in Canada, guns are not allowed. So we left the shotgun below and took these bear bangers, which we took out and fired a few times just to see how effective they were. And they made a nice, great big noise, and they would tend to scare the bears away. And the people at the Torngat National Park thought that was a great idea, and they liked that. Yes?
While you were visiting Greenland, did you see any part of it that your grandfather-in-law, Dr. Forbes, had been involved with? He'd helped map it using Morrissey.
It was Labrador that he did in that. And yes, we put into Seaplane Cove, where he acted as that was his home base for all the flights that they took at that point. And then as we went further north, it was from Seaplane Cove up to the McClellan Straits, and around that area is where he did all his mapping. And we were there for probably a week on that trip, up and back.
And Was that in part what he described in the quest for the Northern Air Route?
No, that was the Northern Air Route was one when he was on the
Morrissey,
the Ernestina Morrissey, and that was in 1941-42 when he was the commander of the Navy commander in charge of that expedition with Bob Bartlett on board as the skipper of the vessel at that point.
Aerial mapping was so accurate that the charts still essentially use his coastline, and users like us have the satisfaction of knowing that whatever errors there may be in the soundings, at least the outline of the coast is extremely accurate. So you would plot your position quite largely by using radar and getting your distance off one headland and another, but as plotted by that survey.
There's a book that they wrote. This was an expedition that was sort of funded by, it was funded by the American Geographic Society, not the National Geographic, but the American. And there's a book that they put in Mapping Northernmost Labrador that I think you could maybe find. It was sort of privately published, but you could probably find it on eBay or Amazon if you look hard enough for it. It's a pretty neat book. It's got some fabulous photographs. I was trying to figure out how I could put some of those photographs up here tonight, but it was just wait. I mean, you saw how bad I am with just a computer. It wasn't going to work. Yeah.
An additional comment on people who are concerned about polar bears at the Torngat Mountain National Park base camp. I believe it's has electrical fencing. And the guides you can hire to go either in the backcountry or around the camp have rifles.
That's correct. So. They're only Inuit bear hunters are allowed to carry the rifles. And they actually tell you that if you're in the camp and the bear alarms go off in the middle of the night, everybody is to stay in their tent. Don't go out to see what's going on. Just hunker down, let the guys who've got the guns to go out there, because if you walk out there and if it's dark enough, all they see is motion sometimes. So you better be careful. So, but it's very interesting how they deal with it. They also told us up there that the polar bear population in northern Labrador and in the Quebec Nunavut area is quite healthy. They seem, even though the sea ice seems to go away a little earlier, they seem to have figured out a strategy for coming in from the water and blocking any seal from getting back into the water again. They're very pretty stealthy. There was one on our first trip, Bill, when we were going up the coast. We were in the thick fog, and all of a sudden we saw this little bergy bit up ahead of us, but it was moving, and we were about 5 miles off the coast. And this bear was coming from offshore back in. So they're pretty healthy swimmers. Yeah?
You mentioned some challenges with navigation, single line of sound and things like that. What other kinds of challenges do you run into and how do you overcome navigation?
Bill, I'm going to turn that one over to you.
Well, I think the key thing, as Skip already said, is where there is only a single line of soundings, the prudent navigator simply sticks with that line. And to do so accurately, you would use your radar more than you would your GPS, because the charts themselves are old, and you may have your latitude and longitude correctly, but they don't. So they're not going to line up.
Didn't we find that there was a quarter mile difference between what the GPS was showing on our chart plotter compared to what the radar would show us?
That's about right. That's typical, and that's just how far off the 100-year-old grid they were using is.
Not on resolution. It's certainly very accessible nowadays. I mean, you can go out and buy the transducers for these. I mean, a Garmin unit with a transducer on it. You can have forward-looking sonar now that gives you a pretty good picture of the bottom ahead of you, which is, you know, up there would be fabulous. Anyone else?
Well, then, thank you all very much. Appreciate it.